Hello, Nana here. Welcome back to Path of Exile. Before we get into the sewers, I want to show you a couple of gear upgrades we did. Started zoomed out because we are building two unique items now. On the one hand, we have Duresso's Passion, which is a pokey pokey sword which gives us a chance to gain frenzy charges on a kill. Which is something I talked about last episode, actually a couple of episodes already. I've been talking about that not generating enough charges because it's only with a 25% chance with one of the hands. I think it's the main hand or the off hand. Either way, it's one hand that gets you the charges. Now we get 25% chance on both hands in addition to the 25 with one. So 50% chance with one hand, 25% with the other. I like those odds way, way better. Also, as long as we don't have any frenzy charges, our damage is pretty massively increased. 72% increased damage for this weapon, I am assuming. Downside is that frenzy charges last a little shorter, but because it massively increases the chance of generating them, I'm happy with that since it will keep up in fights. On the other hand, we have Jack the Axe, which causes bleeding on hit, so we can guarantee getting bleeding with our axe, and our axe is the main damager of the two. Axes are slow and they hit hard. That's perfect for bleeding because that gives you the largest bleeding stacks possible, or not stacks, but the largest bleeding impact. If we, by virtue of the percentage chance based chances we get from our gratuitous violence, that's what it was called, and later on also from blood in the eyes, and of course from, let's see, not bloodletting, melee chance to bleed, and there is another one over there. If they trigger bleeding with the sword, sure, but if we get a stronger bleeding stack from our axe, that is going to take precedence over the other, since bleeding always applies the highest bleeding damage per second that is active right now, and if that all falls off, then if a lower level one is still available, it will just fall over to that. So this has the downside that it reduces how much life we leech, but it does add its own physical attack damage leeched as life. And as you just heard, it's an axe that talks. It actually just makes all kinds of witty remarks as we play. So the damage as a result has increased. We used to do about 2500 points of damage. Now we're doing 3700. So our damage went up by about 60%, which is quite a bit. And let's see. Also, Enduring Cry. It works pretty well for generating endurance charges if you are surrounded. So I added that one to the build. Blood Rage didn't do that because we now have Duresso's Passion, which basically gives the same effect, 25% chance to gain a frenzy charge, but without 4% of our life being lost per second due to the debuff. So in the end, this is for the better. Our previous sword had some lightning resistance on it, so I had to upgrade this ring, which wasn't pretty useful, but now it has the resistance to match. And as before, we're still maxed out and we got a pretty decent chaos resistance. I think we lost a little bit of chaos resist here, but that's that. So let's get started. Because we now guarantee the bleeding every other hit, much more monsters in a group will be bleeding, and as a result, the bleeding explosions are gonna trigger a lot more often. And the larger the group, the more monsters in the group that will end up exploding, the more satisfying it is to just watch them all explode at the same time. Especially fun with those roller beetles upstairs that get spawned by the beetle queens. Oh, and maybe we should get our golem back. But like that, you get nice, happy, satisfying explosions. So the current league is gonna run till the, I believe, the 29th. It was depending on time zone, it's going to be either upcoming Sunday or Monday that it will roll over for you. And then either there's going to be a temporary thing that hasn't been announced yet, or I believe as we had last time, we'll just have a couple of days where there's only going to be the standard, the permanent leagues, standard and hardcore leagues there. And there's going to be no temporary league. So I will be probably spending quite a bit of time during the next weekend to just record a bunch of episodes with this character. To, well, finish the game at least and get started on maps. Because, well, we kind of want to do that, right? That was my goal. We have the mole from the jig. It's my snap. Fine, it's not a mole, but it's a snap. But as you notice, we are still just as tanky as before. But more damage with slightly less leech is still a lot of staying power. And because monsters die a lot quicker, it works out for the better. Frenzy charges recharge quickly as well, and that only boosts our damage even further. And as before, frenzy charges were less reliable, now they are more reliable, so the damage bonus from frenzy is going to be up way more often. And I definitely need to remember to open up a fight with Nurnkry. Like so, just to get some charges up. So that if the inevitable Immortal Call kicks in, we will actually have some charges to work with. Because remember, Enduring Cry, it works even with just one monster. Interesting. That's a 4 link and a 2 link on the Karuumo. Okay, we now have 2 of the busts and we have a waypoint. That's rather efficient at this point. Also, let's head to town since we do have a lot of stuff in our inventory. And getting rid of it is very useful. 2 out of 3. So everything. Selling this one because the 6 sockets gives us 7 jewelers orbs, which is always nice. And I doubt we will be finding a lot of gear upgrades because we have decent gear for right now. Upside of playing with traded gear is that you usually get gear that's slightly above your level in terms of item level, but that can't be in terms of requirements. So the base is always going to be appropriate, but you'll just get better rolls on average than you normally would. I think we were gonna boost this one anymore, were we? It's 8900 points. Yeah, that's roughly 1/3. So we lock those in. Next time we get Molten Shell, that's gonna be the next kill, probably. And we need to release that one in as well. Like that. Got slightly blinded there, makes it harder to hit things. Molten Shell also doesn't get upgrades anymore. Oh, dead end. And a strongbox. Two strongboxes with those bleeding explosions. Rather satisfying. So in terms of skill progression from here on out, we're also gonna focus on defensive things, because, well, as I've mentioned before, we are doing pretty good in terms of offense. So all that's left is just shoring up our defenses a bit. And we are currently level 67. We have 2 skill points for killing Piety, 1 skill point for freeing the Shred in Act 4. And after that we only have leveling points. And it's going to be about 14 points till we get all of the nodes in the Scion Life Wheel from where we are right now. and getting some small armor bonuses and life regen bonuses and things like that along the way. So that means 11 levels from now, which is level 78, we will have our life boosted to, well, a number that will probably stay on for a while. But sign life wheel is worth about 50 points. 550 percentage points, that is. So that's gonna get us to. I wouldn't be surprised if we get 1,000 life just from that one. It's worth quite a bit for us. So that's gonna get us to nearly 4,000 life, which is respectable for mid merciless. Now, once you start doing more difficult maps, that's not a whole lot. But while leveling, I think it's respectable. And also keep in mind, Merciless is a bit weird. Because once you have reached the middle of Act 4, the game is kind of over. Because you can't just smoothly progress from there without a lot of grinding, leveling up, and investing in your gear. There is this difficulty ramp. It's not even a curve. It's no curves are usually smooth. This is just a ramp. It almost hits you in the face, that steep it is. And it's unexpected the first time you go through. That's one of those gotchas that they never tell you, and that if you're playing this game as a hardcore player, the first time through, it's gonna hit you in the face and you're gonna lose characters to it. It kind of starts with Mercer Dresso. He is a lot tougher than Calm, even though they are equivalent, so to say, in terms of area level and difficulty, but it's just a really difficult fight. After that, on your way to Malakai, also I completely didn't pay attention to where we were going. But on your way to Malakai, Heidi is pretty brutal for a lot of fights. I mean, maybe it's better for a life with regen based character than it is for an energy shield character. But it's a pretty brutal fight. And especially with the corrupting blood stacking like mad, you really need to manage that. There's a lot of faces in the dark dropping here. Two from a single square here, 2 out of 7. What was the other one? That was the rats, to get a rat's nest. And I think there's a corpse here, so we go in here. So usually, once you hit Act 4, you run Dry Deck a couple times, you go through the mines, you finish the content up in the mines, and then you get yourself the Crystal Veins waypoint. And you just level up till 75. Get yourself some decent gear. Make sure you have at least 4,000 life. Or your energy shield equivalent. Get yourself maxed out elemental resists. If you are using armor, get that up to a decent level. Same for evasion. Just make sure that your gear is in a good spot. So now you can just run some maps, some lower tier maps. And then once you hit 75, 78, something like that, you got over 4,000 life, then it's maybe an idea to do Calm and the Resso. And then after that, just grind some more and just improve your gear some more. And basically, don't really think about doing Malakai until you're close to 80. You have like 5,000 or 6,000 life, and you have a really good amount of armor, and you can do, tier 5, tier 6 maps or something like that. That's my current take on it. Keep in mind, I'm still learning about what the end game actually entails, but so far, that's kind of how I view things. If you have more concise, more clear, or just different take on it, especially if you have based on good experience. Share it in the comments. I would love to know, because it's actually a topic that probably a lot of players have gained the experience, but it isn't really well documented. It's something that's nearly impossible to properly Google on. So like, so what are good life levels to go for, good resistance levels to go for, damage levels to go for by certain stages in the game. A lot of info might be outdated, or it might not even exist in the first place. So I've just been slowly trying to develop a bit of an intuition for it. As I say, it's slow and it's imperfect. And especially on hardcore, it's a road that unfortunately is paved with experience built upon the corpses of your hardcore characters. Which is also why, given that the next expansion, the Atlas of Worlds, is completely focused on the game's end, on the end game, on the maps, which is where I'm actually going to run the entire league. At least I'm going to start the league on softcore. So I'm just going to run a regular Perennis League there rather than Perennis Hardcore, so that the character I start is also the character that I can use for mapping, and that I can just craft into something that is capable of running the endgame content as the league progresses, and just gain a bunch of valuable experience with the endgame. Because trial and error for endgame content is, well, frankly, it's really tough. Because getting to Merciless takes a while. It's actually for the fun of it. Slash plate. I've played for nearly 40 hours on this character. Keep in mind that does include alt top time in between recording sessions. Usually I record for about 25 minutes. Then I might actually just do an upload of the video while I'm in my hideout. In my hideout, working on my gear, doing some crafting, maybe doing some trading, things like that. But if you were to sit down and dedicatedly play through 30 hours to get to Merciless is not a weird time estimate. Also, it's nice that we found the marketplace from the marketplace, but we're really looking for the bust, so that was not it. But I'm currently at level 67. I'm one level below the lowest level of the maps, of the tier 1 maps. So if I had already unlocked maps with another character, I could roughly start mapping now. Might not be smart or wise, but I could. But if you know, trial and error for the endgame is a really difficult way to actually learn it. Because then every time you make an error, you'll be 30 plus hours down the road again before you can actually resume playing and hopefully learn from your mistake. And if you don't learn a lesson immediately, or you draw the wrong conclusion from an experience, then it might be that you lose multiple characters in a row before you either learn the lesson, or without actually learning lessons, or before you discover something else that you still need to know. So with that all in mind, I've been playing my Frostbolt character on Standard League just to learn a bit more about the endgame in a rather safe environment. But honestly, I don't want to play in Standard League. I want to play in the temporary leagues, so starting in standard mode for the temporary league, so it is going to be regular essence league for us, seems like the way to go to combine both of it. And now in standard league, you don't get you can't lose your character. That's the reason why I'm playing it, of course, because I want to get to the end game. But on the other hand, there is a certain thrill and adrenaline rush that is just tied to playing a character that you can lose in content you are barely able to do. And the rush you get from when you do make it through, that's amazing. I still remember just vividly the adrenaline rush I had, just how intense that was when I first did Izaro on normal with my Juggernaut when Piranha's League was out. Keep in mind, that was Izaro on normal before he was nerfed. And that was a fight, I think it lasted for 2 minutes. But it felt like it lasted for 2 hours, and it was an amazing roller coaster. We're gonna do the catacombs, huh? And I don't think you get that level of excitement in standard because there's not that much on the line. I might be mistaken about that. But we will find out together next season, which is gonna start in 2 weeks, less than 2 weeks. Not less than 2 weeks, actually. I think the counter said 9 days. Time flies when you're having fun. And if you're not having fun, time flies still. Anyway, also we're getting how many? 20 stacks of blood, and our life was not going down. This is why Life Leech is so much fun. If you combine it with regen and things like that. If you have a proper sustain tank, boom, immortality, it's so close then. Let's not autopilot this, because that might result in my death. I thought you were going there and we have a nice dance or something. Oh, you're going the wrong way. Jeez. Now there's etchings on the floor and all that, but seriously. Okay. Don't mind me, just coming through. So you might wonder why the axe is screaming things like yes, yes, more. That's apparently because the axe, you've made a blood pact with it. You leech life, and in exchange it leeches some life along with you. And that works out for the better, because it's a pretty powerful weapon. And that's 5 out of 6. Also means we are done in here. And we can get out again. Wait, we need to be up here. Come on, seriously. Okay, we keep him up there. Every once in a while, Whirling Blades does get stuck behind something, and then I'm very happy that I've got a Leap Slam to just get out of trouble quickly. So we found the back wall. Makes me wonder if we just bypassed the waypoint. Let's look for it. Would be useful if we would find a Decanter Spiritus somewhere. Okay, so there's the exit. Let's look for the waypoint. And next episode we can just pick up from here. Ooh, hello there, Eon Graver. They're not really looking all that happy now though. Yeah. I think at this point I might actually just have to start hiding blue items, since most of the time they're really not that interesting. I believe in serving life. Unless you got a pretty big stack of regals and exalts in order to craft them up into something strong. I don't think they're gonna be all that interesting. Let's see. Oh yeah, we can do inventory Tetris. Yes, we can. Roller beetles. And that's a cutlass. That's gonna stay there. And there it is. The Ganta Spiritus in the ornate chest. Which also we can't pick up. It's not being pinpointed on the map. Okay, let's make a very, very quick town stop just to empty our stuff into the chest. I'll quickly find everything else that's left on the map. And we can hand in the bust. Ooh, actually, we gained another skill point from this. It's just going to be 77, not 78, when we complete everything. So, this was the final piece of the puzzle. Gets more armor, movement speed, and a life regen. So, currently, armor is at 2500. It's going to go up to almost 2800. And our life regen in town is 158. And we gain about 90 from the golem. So, that gets us to 250 life per second. Which is about 8%, roughly. I'd say we are doing pretty well there. We left something behind, didn't we? Yeah. Let's grab it. Also, we might as well just turn around to the other side and look for the ornate chest. Yes. We are now stuck with it, but we're gonna run the dogs first. Before the temples. So we can just drop it out there. And usually... the decanter is not too far away from the waypoint. I'm puzzled now. This flies in the face of all the experience I've had so far. Ooh, Archon. Let's open it up. More items, summons skeletons. Chaos Orb. That's pretty nice. Chisel, some of these blacksmith whetstones. I've been using quite a bit of them. Just changing in and out of gear rather frequently. So I could do with some more currency. And there's the waypoint. I was already thinking, if you find the decanter, it's usually pretty close to the waypoint. So, yeah. You know what? This is probably a good spot to... Oh, we need to kill our buddy Marseilles. How could we not? That's really rude of me. I'm just gonna apologize in advance to Marseilles. Then plant a blade and an axe in his stony body. Anyway. Rage shouting. Okay. You guys, stop being annoying. Yes. Totem. And we just murder the heck out of him. Suddenly your target disappears. And that was Marseilles, and he didn't have the decency to drop good loot. Probably because I completely didn't think about him. He just didn't have the time to prepare some decent drops. That must be it. Self-centered adventure thoughts. It's all about me. Mobs just didn't have time to prepare. And then we are here. And this is where I'm gonna end the episode. So, as always, I'm gonna thank you very much for watching. And I'll see you again next time when we venture forth into the battlefront, the docks, Solaris Temple, Lunaris Temple, all the fun stuff. Bye bye.